यू कैन गाइड. सेइंग दिस आई वुड लाइक टू इंट्रोड्यूस टुडे स्पीकर डॉक्टर अपार साहू जी एंड टुडेज टॉपिक विल बी इम्यूनिटी बूस्टिंग थ्रू योगा. A small introduction. It's an immense pleasure for me to introduce or brief about our today's speaker, Dr. Apar Saho ji. Sir has completed his graduation in the year 2009 from the SDM College of Naturopathy and Yogic Science, PhD from Yashwasa Bangalore in the year 2018. Sir is the top scorer in the batch 2004 to 2009 of BNYS. He has achieved 3 gold medal and Dr. D. Veerendra Hegde Pattabhishek Award for his academic excellence. He has served as a lecturer and medical officer in SDM College of Naturopathy and Yogic Science, Ujre. He was an associate professor in SVSA Bangalore in academics. He was academic head for MD program. And presently, sir is the principal of the School of Yoga and Naturopathic Medicine, SVSA Bangalore. He is also an external moderator for the School of Natural Medicine, Faculty of Community Medicine, University of Western Cape, Cape Town, South Africa. He is an internal and external examiner of BNYS examination for Rajiv Gandhi University of Health Science. A chief superintendent of examination, SVSA Bangalore. He is a recognized guide for PhD at SVSA and AIIMS Rishikesh, supervising 6 medical scholars. He has guided 5 MD students from yoga and rehabilitation, 2 MD students of yoga, and 3 MSc students of yoga therapy, and several BNYS dissertation program is being headed by sir. He is also a member of Scientific Advisor Committee and Internal Ethic Committee, Jindal Nature Care Hospital, Bangalore. He has published research papers on neurocognitive and changes following Kumbhaka yogic breathing. He is a peer reviewer. This was a brief introduction about sir. Experience is the only teacher we have. We may talk and reason all our lives, but we shall not understand a word of truth. Saying this, I would ask our guest speaker to share their immense knowledge and experience with our dear students. Over to you, sir.
Thank you so much, Dr. Lakshmi, for that generous introduction. It is my pleasure and honor to be with all of you this morning. And I must congratulate the entire team of the Government College of Mysore under the leadership of the dynamic principal, Dr. Radhakrishna Ramarao, who has been actively conducting these sessions to ensure that public is benefited at large and the students are also getting knowledge from all over. So I must congratulate Honorable Principal Sir and thank him for inviting me here today morning. And the topic that we are talking today is about immunity and yoga. And although there is a lot of scientific work that is happening on the topic, I have chosen to talk a little different aspect of immunity. May I request everybody to please mute yourself? Thank you. So, what is the philosophical understanding of immunity and yoga? What are the connections? And although the topic is how do we boost immunity, I would possibly refrain from saying that we can actually boost immunity. And as I go along the presentation, I will elaborate on that. But the key take-home message in the beginning that I would like to state is that you can't really boost immunity. You will rather be optimizing immunity. Now, To begin with, I'm sure all of you are hearing this time and again. Due to COVID, again, it has become all the more important. We are talking of immunity left, right, and center. The ability to resist pathogens. The pathogens are basically disease-causing agents, and they can be bacteria, virus, fungi, parasites. It can be also the toxins that are produced within our body. So now the whole point is, what exactly does immunity do? Immunity is a part of a larger physiological understanding of what our body does. Our body essentially maintains an internal environment all the time. And this maintenance of internal environment is also called as homeostasis. Now, you do not want an external agent to change the internal environment. That is exactly how our bodies are made. The moment there is a change in temperature outside, we have either behavioral changes or physiological changes to compensate it. You know, the clothings change when we shift from summer to winter. During summers, we sweat, right? So the temperature regulation is just an example of what homeostasis does, but it is to do with everything in the body, right? Our heart beats in a critical range of, beats per minute. Our blood pressure has a critical range in which it moves around. There is a critical range of, everything in the body. The pH of your blood is also maintained, and everything. There are so many mechanisms to ensure that we remain what we are. Okay, so homeostasis is essentially the state of health. Now, immunity is a part of this larger homeostatic mechanism where we are fighting any entry of the untoward organism or toxin which is coming from outside or produced inside, and you want to neutralize that, right? Now, ever since COVID came in picture, we are talking of immunity boosting, and unfortunately that word somehow doesn't really convey the meaning that we want to actually do. We have different products, right, from the traditional Ayurvedic prescriptions to, you know, yoga to naturopathy modalities to, fancy products today that we're talking about, immunity boosting breads to ice creams to everything, right? But the question is, are we really going to enhance or boost immunity, or is it possible? Is it doable, and is it really required? So let us try and understand what immune system does. Immune system, as we understand, is the army of the body, right? You have the defense personnel in the body, and they are supposed to have weapons. They are supposed to have training. They are supposed to have an absolute control and understanding about who is the enemy and who is not. Now, even with respect to COVID, people are not dying because of COVID, the coronavirus infection as such. Many of them are dying because of the excessive immune response, what we call a cytokine storm. You know, the chemicals in the body that are produced for mitigating or countering the infection, they are in excess, and that can create a problem. And therefore, we do not really want an excessively hyper-reactive army. You know, when the army personnel are trained, they are trained for years together before they are put on border. Similarly, our immune system also is trained in a manner where we want the immune system to react in a particular way and not just be reactive to every situation that is coming around. If there is a stone thrown, you need not react. But if there is a bomb thrown, you have to react. And that differentiation is what is the part of the training of immune system that has to happen. So the factors that affect immune response include three major components, I would say, that is training, which is the exposure to antigens. Okay, the active way of doing it is by infections or by vaccines. You know, you put in vaccine and then there is an immunological response to it, and that helps your body to identify whenever there is a pathogen, actual pathogen coming. You must have seen that, you know, in movies, when army training happens, they have these dummy bodies on which they do practice of shooting. So that's exactly what happens when, you know, the vaccines are given. So training is extremely important when it comes to an optimal immune response. Okay. Second is the ammunition. Ammunition is basically the guns that your immune system would have. And that depends on the food that we consume. So if the food is faulty, the guns are faulty, your immune response is not going to be correct. And therefore, we need to eat what is right for us. Okay. Otherwise, without guns, even if the trained soldier is in the field, probably they're not going to get an optimal immune response. The third part of what is important with immune system is the relaxation, the rest. If you are not sleeping for, say, 2 days, you are going to be hyperactive. Okay, so it is very important that we also give deep rest to our body, to our mind, to ensure that your immune system is functioning at its best. Okay. And that can be done using rest, proper sleep, relaxation. You can use, you know, techniques of yoga. Yoga nidra can be used. Meditations can be used. Stress management, talking to friends. People are confined to their own homes these days. So the yoga day is all the more important because we want the mental agony that people are going through to be taken care of before, you know, the immune response is just like that said to be boosted. And please remember that no food can take care of the training. No training can take care of the rest. So all these components are going to be important when it comes to immune response. You can't just have one item on agenda and say that, yes, I have achieved the best possible immune response. That is not possible. So immunity or homeostasis is all about balance. You know, you want the immune response to be optimal so that any foreign cells or toxins are neutralized, but the immune system, the bombs which are available, the guns that are available with the immune system, which we call as immunoglobulins, or, you know, the interleukins to cytokines, all of them are not harming the body. Okay, so you need to require optimal immune system or balanced immune system for good health. Now, whenever there is an imbalance where the foreign cells are not considered enemy, or the enemy cells are not considered to be enemy, and the immune response is lower. Just 1 second, somebody is at home. Yes, I'm sorry. I was talking about the balance. And if, you know, your body cells are not identifying something that is harmful, that leads to a reaction like cancer. Okay. What happens in cancer? The cells are abnormal and your body cells, the immune cells, are unable to identify them. And that is why they start growing. Okay. On the other side, if your own cells are identified as something that is triggering an immune response, you can end up with autoimmune diseases. So therefore, we do not want a lowered immune response. We do not want an exaggerated immune response. We want an optimal, a balanced immune response if we want to be healthy. Okay. Now, all of you are students of yoga. Can somebody tell me the definition of yoga that has balance in it? The word balance. Anyone? You could please unmute and tell me. Yes, Namita says Samatvam Yoga Ucchate. That's absolutely correct, Namita. And that's what is the point that I'm trying to make here. It is not about enhanced immune response or immune boosting, but rather achieving an optimal immune response. Okay. So having said that, how does yoga, naturopathy, Ayurveda philosophy looks at health? Like Namita said, Samatvam Yoga Ucchate, according to yoga, is the state of equanimity. We also in naturopathy understand that the Panchamahabhutas that are there, they have to be in balance. Excessive of any of the Panchamahabhutas will create a problem. A deficiency of the Panchamahabhutas is going to create a problem. In the acupuncture model, we have yin and yang, where we also understand that there is a part of yin in yang and there is a yang in yin. So there is a balance that is there again, found in all these philosophies. The most beautiful explanation probably comes from Ayurveda, where the health is defined as, you know, the balance of the different components that compose human being. You know, the Agni, the Doshas, the Malas, the Dhatus, everything has to be in balance. And that is the state of Arogya or health. So all the traditional health philosophies and practices talk about balancing and not boosting. Okay. Now, the imbalance rather, what are the causes? What are the causes of imbalance? In yoga, we talk of what is called as viparyaya. The chitta vrittis, if you are trying to understand, the second vritti that has been spoken about is wrong knowledge. Okay. Also the third one, delusion, vikalpa. So those two is you start misunderstanding a good body cell as a foreign cell, mount a response, there is a vikalpa. You start misunderstanding the bad body cells, that is, you know, your cancer cells, as a good cell, again, a delusion. So that is what is viparyaya and vikalpa. We also talk of what is called as avidya, right? The wrong knowledge itself is a problem. Okay, I'm going to elaborate on this particular shloka from Bhagavad Gita in probably coming slide. A beautiful explanation from the second chapter, 62nd and 63rd verse, of how this imbalance at mind can lead to disaster. Okay, in naturopathy, we are aware of this model that we talk about, upastri. And whenever I go as an examiner for the colleges in PNC exam, And I ask, what is the primary cause of disease? People say lowered vitality, abnormal composition of blood and lymph, etc. But if you are reading the philosophy in detail, you would understand that these are primary manifestations and not primary causes. The primary cause of all illnesses is, you know, going away from nature, okay, for not obeying natural laws. And that can be through ignorance, indifference, indulgence, and lack of self-control, which are demonstrated as the roots of the entire disease tree or opus tree that we talk about. So now, you can disobey natural laws. Human being is the only animal in the world which eats whenever they want. All other animals in the world eat only when they are hungry. And that is why we have got all the food-related disorders that we have. All the other animals do have what is called as a circadian rhythm. You know, there are people, there are animals which are nocturnal animals. There are animals which are, the day-living animals. Human beings, no, sorry, we don't listen. We want to wake up, watch movies at the night, do not want to wake up early. And all these small little habits lead to a state of what is called as allostasis. Homeostasis is basically a normal response or maintaining the normalcy in the body. Allostasis is a word that is used for an abnormal maintenance. Say a patient with high blood pressure perceives, their body perceives that the blood pressure at a higher level is normal. So it tries maintaining it at that level. So that happens because of all these imbalances that we create through our lifestyle. Okay. The story of Mahabharata and Duryodhana is something that I would like to mention here. Duryodhana was a very strong person, in fact, stronger than most of the Pandavas except Bhima. Okay. But he lost because of his attitude. Okay. And there is a very famous statement of Duryodhana in which he says, I know what is right, but I choose to do things otherwise. I know what I'm doing is wrong, but I am compelled to do that. Each one of us, all of us are Duryodhanas in some way or other. You know, in our second, third, fourth standard science textbooks, we have learned that things that are too fried and kept in open, unhygienic things are bad for health. Okay. And eating fruits and vegetables are good for health. Exercising is good for health. But unfortunately, in all BNYS colleges, unfortunately, people come to yoga just because there is attendance to it and not because they can be healthy. You know, we know that yoga is going to be useful to us, but we don't do it for our own selves. We do it for somebody else. We choose not to exercise. We choose not to eat healthy food. We choose to eat what is unhealthy. Okay. And that is what creates a problem for all of us. So each one of us has this psychology of Duryodhana in all of us. And we need to change that if we want to really make a difference in, you know, the way we want immunity to go ahead. The way Karma Yoga looks at it, the third chapter of Bhagavad Gita talks about this, that as human beings, we have got the choice of doing things in a particular way. Okay, there is a burger shop and next to it, there is a juice shop. You can choose which shop do you want to go to, right? And that the choice is described as kartum, akartum, anyatha kartum. Kartum is to do things the way everybody else does it. Akartum is not doing anything. Anyatha kartum is doing it differently. If you want to be different. If you want to be recognized as a great doctor, you cannot just go on repeating doing things that everybody else is doing. You will have to do things little differently. And that is a very, very important aspect of, you know, again, what yoga gives ability for us to do. Now, why am I talking it in context of immunity? Because it's my choice whether to sleep in time or not, whether to eat proper food or not, whether to exercise or not, whether to do yoga or not. My choice makes sure that I remain healthy, my state of homeostasis is maintained, my weight is maintained, there is no excessive inflammation in my body, my immune system is working optimally. All of that depends on my choice of doing things. My choice of whether I want to wear a mask or not in the pandemic. Yes, it is difficult. It is not easy to wear a mask and go around every day. But that is the only known protective mechanism for now. Are we not responsible for our own health? Is a question that we have to ask ourselves now. I want to tell you a story from Chandogya Upanishad. It's a beautiful story. You know, all Upanishads talk about these stories from the teacher and the student. So one of the students asked his teacher, what is it that the whole creation, the whole world has come out from? Okay. So the teacher, there is no spoon feeding in Upanishads. All the Upanishads are all about making people experiment and learn. So the teacher says, okay, go ahead. There is a banyan tree in front of you. Just get me a fruit of a banyan tree. So this student runs and goes, gets a banyan tree fruit. And if you have seen the banyan tree fruits, they look like this. They have small, tiny seeds like granules. So the teacher says, take out one seed and split it, make it half. So the student makes it in half. What is there inside? There is nothing. It's hollow. Now, the question is, from a hollow seed, the entire creation has come out, right? Now, how is it possible? The whole beauty from Chandogya Upanishad's learning is that everything, the entire banyan tree, originates from nothing. But do you think every seed that is there on banyan tree will get transformed into a tree? Not really. There has to be suitable environment, right? The seed has to fall on a soil that is fertile. It has to get water. It has to, you know, have sunlight. And only then it will grow as a tree. Our immune system and diseases, both, are like that. The immune system can be strong, can be responsive, if we create that environment in the body. Disease-causing agents can create a disease only if we have the environment for the disease to, you know, prosper within the body. So it's our choice to decide which side do we want to be, right? And that choice is what is given to us by, you know, the Panchakosha model that we talk about, using the Vijnanamaya Kosha, the wisdom, to conquer the physical, very gross issues that we have today. It is very important that we understand that there is something called as the psycho-neuro-immunological axis that the scientists are talking today for last about 45, 50 years. What it means is basically my thought process, my emotions are going to have an impact on the way my immune system functions. And therefore, I need to be in a positive state of mind. I need to be in a comfortable zone with my own self. And that will happen only when we use our own wisdom to be healthy. How Adi becomes Vyadi, I think, you know, your faculty members in yoga therapy as well as other yoga subjects will also talk about it. This is a model that one of my PhD colleagues, Dr. Vijaya Kavuri, who has worked in yoga and IBS, has proposed. And this comes from basically Yoga Vasistha, where we say the Adi or the mental conflicts basically affect the Pranamaya Kosha, and then it leads to either excessive prana, reduced prana, or, you know, and that leads to what is called as ajirnatva, atijirnatva, and kujirnatva, before it leads to a physical health problem. Okay, so when we are talking of immune system, I'm going to replace this with the immune system and understand that my mind, when it is in conflict, it is going to affect my pranamaya kosha and lead to a excessive immune response or a subclinical immune response and not an optimal one. And that is where we will have to start working at the root cause and not just talk about eating some immune boosting amla or chaman prash or things like that. You need to work at every level to ensure that, you know, your immune system is in proper balance. Just to compare the prana and immune system, we talk of lowered prana, excessive prana, both creating health problems, lowered immune response and hyperimmune response, both creating problem. And the goal is to reach what is called as the samana sthiti, the samana prana, which is balancing. And that is achieved through optimal immunity. The Bhagavad Gita model talks about this beautiful shloka that I was mentioning earlier. Dhyayato vishayan pumsaha sangaste shupajayate sangat sanjayate kamaha kamat krodho bhijayate krodhat bhavati sammohaha sammohat smriti vibhramaha smriti bhramshat buddhinasho buddhinashat pranashyati. Simple attachment can lead to, you know, a desire leading to anger leading to delusion leading to, you know, lack of discrimination, and that discrimination leads to disaster. A very well defined model that is given to us by our scriptures on understanding how our health, and not just health but also the psyche, is affected just by being attached. And therefore, you should be working at the level of attachment. The Karma Yoga way of doing things is very, very important. Another very important concept about being in yoga is to be mindful. Today, our problem is that when we are in a particular state, we are either thinking of past or future. We are never in the present. Even now, probably a lot of you who are watching this webinar are also thinking about other things like, you know, breakfast at home, or, you know, what will be cooked for lunch, etc., and so many other things. But if you are in present, that is the state that yoga wants us to achieve. This picture talks about the same thing. You know, a man and his daughter are going to a place where there are hills and there is sun rising. Okay. The daughter is able to see the sun rising and the hills. But even in this place, this man is busy thinking about his office, his laptop, his work, his traffic, and all of those things. Can you enjoy, you know, going to a beautiful place and still not be? Being there is not going to help. And therefore, yoga talks of working in present, being mindful. The mindful attention, mindful awareness is very, very important component of yoga. So if you're doing asanas without that mindfulness, you're not actually doing asanas, you're just doing some physical acrobatics. which will have some benefit, but it will not give you the benefit of doing yoga. Okay. Now, connecting it with another principle of philosophy, that is Triguna. We have, all of us have Sattva, Rajas and Tamas in us. Tamas is basically the dharmasi, the drowsiness, etc. Rajas is the excessive energy, drive, etc. Sattva is balance. Again, the immunity is all about reaching that balance. And therefore, if we have the sattvic mindset, the immunity is going to be optimal. Otherwise, it is either going to be lowered or excess. So it's not just about doing asana or pranayama for immune boosting, but adapting, the entire lifestyle of yoga. Shat Kriyas, by definition, the first shloka in Hatha Yoga that talks about Shat Kriya says, whenever there is an imbalance of Medha or Shleshma, then you perform Shat Karma. But Anyastu na charetani doshanam samabhavataha. When the doshas are balanced, you should not be doing Shat Kriyas. So the state of balance is described in different yoga texts in different ways, but the meaning is the same, that all of us need to attain a beautiful state of balance. So the $1 million question that we are asking today is, what yoga should I do to optimize my immunity, right? You might have expected that I am going to put in some asanas, some pranayamas, but I am again putting a shloka from Bhagavad Gita, which says, yuktahara viharasya yukta cheshtasya karmasu yukta swapna avabodhasya yogo bhavati dukkha, which means there has to be a balance in eating and recreation, work, sleep, and the entire lifestyle is what we have to make yogic. And that is going to optimize our immunity, and not just doing XYZ asana or pranayama. Okay, I am doing asana and pranayama, but my sleep is hampered. My immune response is not going to be good. I am doing asana and pranayama, but I am not resting well. My immune response is not going to be good. I am doing asana or pranayama or meditation, but my food habits are not correct. My immune response is not going to be correct. And therefore, the key is lifestyle. We have to adapt a natural, a yogic lifestyle to be having optimal immune response. And therefore, my dear students, I think I will end with this particular slide, saying that do not limit yoga therapy. Yoga is not yoga therapy. Yoga therapy is just one application of the yoga that we have. And therefore, please adapt yogic lifestyle in every act, every single day. Even you are walking, you are talking, everything has to become yogic. There has to be a moderation or a state of balance, a state of relaxation, a state of awareness, a state of mindfulness in every act that we do. And when we do that, naturally, the immunity, not just immune system, but the whole system, all different systems in the body are definitely going to be in balance. You will have optimal health. With that, wishing all of you a very healthy, happy International Day of Yoga. I thank once again the Government College Mysore to invite me to share my thoughts on the yogic wisdom and immunity today. Thank you, Ramarao sir, for calling me to talk to your students. Thank you, Bharat. Thank you, Lakshmi, for coordinating the whole thing. If there are any questions, I would be more than happy to answer them.
Students, if you have any doubts, please do interact with sir. That was a very informative class, actually. Generally, students think that yoga is a very difficult subject to understand. With a very good example in a simpler manner, hope they have understood that, yes, yoga also is a very simple subject. We can learn as the other subjects. Thank you so much, sir, for being a part of this e-guest series, which is conducted, organized by our college, Government Nature Care and Yoga College. On behalf of our principal, our college, and everyone, we thank you. Heartfully thank you. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Hello. Thank you, Dr. Lakshmi.
Excuse me, sir?
Yes, yes.
Sir, could you please explain dhyayato vishanna pumshaha?
Okay.
Vishayana pumshaha.
Okay. Dhyayato vishayan pumsaha is the beautiful shloka from Bhagavad Gita, which talks about how the attachment causes disaster. Okay. It is so beautifully explained by Shri Krishna as a series of events. So when we are doing an experiment in biochemistry or any other lab, we do have steps, right? One after another. Similar steps are described about how, you know, being attached to an object and doing the act can lead to several other complications. So he says, dhyayato vishayan pumsaha. So when you see a vishaya, that is the object, when there is an attachment of you with the object, then sangha will come. There is an attachment. Sangat sanjayate kamaha. When there is an attachment, there is desire. When your desires are not fulfilled, and this may happen with a simple thing like, you know, you like some food and that is not cooked at home, right? But what happens when it is not cooked at home? You get angry. Kamat krodho abhijayate, krodhad bhavati sammohaha. When there is anger, you are not thinking correctly. At that time, you may shout on your mother, throw tantrums, etc. So it's very simple. When we are angry, we don't think right. And when we are not thinking correctly, sammohat smriti vibhramaha, our memories are deluded. We will forget all the good things that are done by our mom and we start scolding her, right? Just because she did not make the favorite dish that you have. And then that leads to disaster. Okay? Smriti Bhramshat, Buddhi Nashaha, Buddhi Nashat Pranashyati. Pranashyati is basically the disaster. So where did it all start? It started with the attachment. Okay, so what you need to work upon is being non-attached. That's the Karma Yoga approach. It's very simple. What does Karma Yoga talk about? Karma Yoga says, do your work, but do not get attached to the fruits of it. So our problem is we are so attached that we have problems. Okay, and we also know when there is an attachment, there is a series of problems that we can face. And therefore, being non-attached, when you study, don't study for being the topper of the class. Study for just learning. Your results are definitely going to be there, which are good. Okay? But if you are so much excessively worried about the results, you will not be able to perform well in your exams. As simple as that. Why is it that in vivas that you have studied just outside the room, when you come inside and you can't really speak anything? That is because you are too worried that, you know, my results depend on what I speak. You are too anxious about it. All you need to do is mana prashamana upayaha. You need to slow down your mind and that should help. I hope I am answering your question, Parvati.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Once again, thank you so much, sir, for your valuable time and sharing your immense knowledge and experience with us students. Heartily thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
I think another question in chat box is about, are there any particular mechanisms through which yoga can improve immunity? Yes, there are multiple mechanisms. Number one, we need to understand that homeostasis is altered when you are triggering any kind of reaction. So when you're not doing things that are right for you, your immune system is going to go for a toss. Your body starts perceiving everything as a threat. Okay. So one major thing that yoga is going to do is give deep rest to the system. And once that rest is given, naturally, you know, you are not excessively active and then suddenly you are going on the other side of it. So you will definitely be attaining a state of balance. Of course, there are mechanisms where we are talking of optimization of the immune response. We are talking of, you know, immunity being enhanced in patients with cancer. We are also talking of yoga reducing inflammation. So there are so many studies that are available out there. And as yoga naturopathy students, I would highly encourage you to look at actual scientific work that is done in yoga. There is a lot that is available. Please do not do Google search. Do a PubMed search and find out. There are so many studies. And if you are, you know, having any doubts or questions, you can always reach out to your teachers. They are always there to help you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Lakshmi. May I leave?
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. Once again, thank you.
Have a nice day, all of you. Wishing you a wonderful International Day of Yoga.
Thank you, sir. Wish you the same.